Welcome to Actions and Limits. My name is Justin Atherton. I'm a personal coach and the founder of Limitlessness Coaching. With me as always is Paul Fortune. Paul is a business coach and the founder of A Call to Action. And together, we make Actions and Limits. Welcome to the show, the podcast where we talk about the actions we can take and the limits we create. How's your week been, Paul?
It's been great. And I've been dying all week to tell you my story about me in a car. So I've been chomping at the bit, buddy. I really want to talk about it.
I've been waiting, and I haven't asked you. I haven't sent you any messages. I've been like racking my brain for trying to figure out what it is. So let's get into it. Go ahead. I want to hear this story.
All right. So to kind of piggyback of what we talked about last week, and we talked about external things affecting your mood. So this goes right into that.
Okay. External influences. Yeah.
External influences. You're right. So I'm in my car. I'm driving my car that I've had for years and years and years. And I don't drive it that often, but I thought, man, I need to get it out. So I'm taking it to go to the gym. And as I'm pulling out, I noticed my car kept swerving to one side. I'm like, what the heck? And I wasn't able to go as fast. So it got to the point where this is bad. So I pull over and I see that my front passenger tire is completely flat.
Okay.
And my first reaction was anger and frustration, like, I don't want to deal with this right now. I just want to go to the gym and I want to go home, get something to eat. And at that point, I'm like, no, I don't want this to. I had a great day before that, mm-hmm. and I'm not going to let this small little thing affect my mood. So the gas station was a block down, so I decided just to drive it to the gas station to see if I could put air in the tire, right?
Okay.
So drive it there, and then I put the air in, and nothing is going in. Nothing. I mean, it's completely still flat. I'm like, are you serious? I just want to get enough air so I could drive it home and then get my tire fixed, yada, yada, yada.
Yeah.
No, I could not get any air in the tire. So I thought, okay, again, I could let this ruin my day, but you know what? We're going to take a breath. I don't need to be anywhere. I was just going to the gym. There's no appointments. Let it be. And Justin, you know this, but our viewers don't know this. I have a phobia about people parking next to me. I prefer to park far away so nobody parks next to me. So I'm parked next to the air, and there's plenty of other parking at this gas station. And this guy comes up right, and I'm leaning up against my car, and he's parking right next to me. And I'm like, what is this guy doing? And I thought, before I say something to this guy, want to see why he was coming right there. And sure enough, it was to get air. So obviously I'm not going to yell at somebody for doing that because there was only one station for air. So let that go. Fine. Drives away. This and that. Then I called AAA. And they told me it was going to be 15 minutes. Great. 15 minutes. Awesome.
Mm-hmm.
Wait there. Then I get a text saying, oh, the tech got your order. He'll be there in 90 to 120 minutes. And I'm like, are you serious right now? And again, I was like, at that point, I was going to lose it. But I thought to myself, again, don't have to be anywhere.
Mm-hmm.
I'm safe. I'm at by the gas station, so if I want some soda pop or beef jerky, I'm right there. I can get
soda
it.
Soda pop. Got it.
I just turn my radio on and I start singing songs. And sure enough, just singing songs, just silly, stupid songs.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not allowed to play at my restaurant that I go to, play those songs. It just changed my mood. I forgot, you know, why I was mad.
Mm-hmm.
Play guy, he was there. Put the tire on for me. Drove it back home. And the great part about this is this. So I took it to the tire shop, and I've already done, you know, being angry and everything like that. So I'm just gonna drive up in a good mood. I'm just gonna walk to my office after I drop the car off. And he's like, oh, if I can patch it, it's gonna be $25. If I can't, I'll give you a call. Well, he gives me a call, and I'm like, oh no.
Mm-hmm.
And he's like, I can't find a hole in your car, in your tire. So we filled it up with air, and your car's ready. So I go there, and I'm, you know, about to give him $25. No, I didn't have to patch it, so it's free. So I'm like, well, thank you. So what I did was I pulled out my 20, and I personally gave it to him, and I said, thank you for being honest. And it turned out to be a great situation. Great. I felt good about humanity right then and there.
That's awesome. But obviously, I have questions about why your tire was flat if there wasn't a hole in it. But, man, there was so many different things you went through, you know, realizing those emotions are getting triggered, right? And, you know, being able to handle your reaction to them, because that's a huge thing as far as emotional intelligence goes, first off. And then, you know, the repeated, you know, triggers of those emotions, because they just stack up. And then going back to the music, having that external influencer, and what that really is like, it presents you to the moment when you're singing those songs, and just you're like, because that's what you're doing. That was your purpose at that moment. Here, I'm just gonna sing this song and feel whatever, you know, comes up with it. You're already, you know, conceded to having to wait there for 90 to 120 minutes for this guy to show up. So you're like, you assess the situation. You know, you're safe, like you said. You've got access to food and water if you need it. You're like, I'm not, you know, in imminent danger. I don't have to go anywhere. So, you know, I think that's awesome. A little bit goes into the external influencers. Some of it goes into that emotional intelligence. So, no, super awesome to go through.
Glenn, our producer, has a question. Glenn, what was your question?
I'd like to focus on one detail of that story. I think we need a further explanation on. You mentioned there are songs you're not allowed to play at your local restaurant.
You want to go into detail with that one, Paul?
That might be time for another episode. Let me tell you, it's all fun and games. It's nothing bad, guys, viewers. But I definitely get into that story at another time. But there is a reason why I'm not able to play music, and it's all a fun reason why. So I'll get into that in a different episode, but thanks, Glenn, for bringing that up to our viewers.
It is a super funny story. Paul, let's talk about our sponsor real quick again for this week. Frontline Standard Apparel. Frontline Standard is a veteran and law enforcement owned patriotic apparel company based out of Conroe, Texas. And with every product purchased from Frontline Standard, they donate a dollar to a nonprofit organization supporting America's heroes and their families. Frontline Standard is run by a former U.S. Marine from the 3rd Battalion, 7th Marines, who now works as a police officer and wanted a way to give back to those who sacrifice so much on a daily basis. The mission for Frontline Standard is to provide Americans with quality patriotic wear that brings awareness to and supports those who were and are currently on the front line. Frontline Standard supports the military, first responders, and they want us all to look good while we support everyone. And we've got a new code, Paul. So if our listeners go on to frontlinestandardapparel.com, use the discount code ACTIONS20, that's ACTIONS20, they'll get 20% off of their order of any of the apparel. So again, thank you very much, Frontline Standard. All right, Paul, let's bring in our guest for today, Chuck Thrash. He's an architect in California. He grew up always seeking answers to how things worked. Today, 11 years after graduation, he's a partner in a mid-sized architecture firm that specializes in hospital design. While managing a couple dozen projects at a time, he also coordinates the training program for the firm and sits on the Tustin Preservation Conservancy as its president. He spends times with his wife and two boys and has spent the last 3 years building the Garage Mahal in his backyard with his wife, who's also an architect. And Chuck is always seeking to better himself at his profession and as a generalist by broadening the scope of his understanding. And he's currently honing his new skill of neon sign making. So I've seen a little bit of the Garage Mahal.
Beach too. You forgot to add that one in, Justin.
What is it?
He also likes long walks on the beach.
Long walks on the beach. There you go.
Forgot about that.
I'm excited to hear about the Garage Mahal, but I know we're going to get into the firm he works for, you know, and the job he's doing first, but I'm excited about some of this other stuff. So welcome to the show, Chuck.
Well, thanks for having me, guys. It's exciting.
Yeah, thanks for being here. I know we've got some questions for you, Paul. If you want to kick it off, I know you're excited to pick Chuck's brain.
Yeah, let me get it started here.
Slim pickings.
So, in the rarest form, you are an architect, right, Chuck?
Yes, or you could say in a common form, yes, I'm an architect.
All right. So, being an architect, was that a dream of yours in high school, college, or did you take courses and thought, oh, wow, this is something I wanted to do? How did you pick this profession?
Well, that's a story in itself. I remember exactly how it started. Back in sixth grade is when I decided I wanted to be an architect. I had many interests and you know, as I stated, I'm a generalist. I think that's my self-diagnosis. I used to call it my ADHD. You know, I get bored quick. I like to, you know, try things, learn how they work, and then move on and do something else. I, you know, the repetition gets stagnant for me. So back then I thought I wanted to be a scientist because I have kind of a scientific mind and I like taking things apart, see how they work. But I also like to see how many different things work and how they all go together and the context and all that. And at that point, I decided the life of a scientist would be a little monotonous. So I thought, as an architect, the problems will always be unique, and I won't be in the office every day. I'll be able to get out. And I feel like that just fit in with my personality, and I thought that would be the career for me to pursue. So sixth grade is when I decided, and I haven't wavered since. Of course, we always second-guess our path sometimes, but I guess you could say I've stayed pretty true to that.
Well, did you have any, like, toys? Like, you're saying you got it when you were six. So is there anything that your parents taught you? Sixth grade. Got it. A little bit older than six. Sixth grade.
Right.
So things that you did, you know, at that age, or that kind of honed it for you.
Like so I guess what I started working on, one of the things I did was I was always, you know, curious how things work. So aside from taking apart my toys and not being able to get them back together again, which is why I don't make a very good engineer, I would follow my dad around the house and, you know, out of necessity, you know, things would go wrong with the house and, you know, time to put a new roof on or we got to put sprinklers in. And I was always curious. So I'd follow him around and ask how it worked and ask if I could help. And eventually I was kind of doing the stuff myself and thinking of, you know, different ways to do it. And it wasn't just, you know, the pretty things like you think of an architect doing drawings and stuff like that. I'm actually not real great at drawing, but it was just a lot of the practical stuff. And I thought, you know, what better way? You know, I didn't want to be, you know, pigeonholed into, say, being just an electrical engineer and understanding just, you know, one specific system. But I wanted to be in charge of kind of orchestrating all the different systems so that it could have a broad understanding of everything and kind of be, you know, overseeing it all and putting it all together.
Got it. Seeing the big picture rather than just focusing on one aspect of it. Okay. Yeah, I was just trying to get some insight into if there was something that your parents did or provided for you that kind of pushed you in that direction. So, but like, at what point, like college, high school, like what programs were you involved with, or when did you decide I'm going to be an architect?
Well, I definitely decided in sixth grade, and I tend to be stubborn. So from then on, I just kind of thought of what I could do. And I think my entry point, my break into it, was in high school. I was taking an architectural drafting class. And, you know, it was interesting learning how to do hand drawings, which I'd never, ever used again in my life. But I think it was a good tool. I believe in learning context of things helps you understand the thing you really want to know. Mm-hmm. And that's why I'm open to different things. But I met my first mentor there. We had to do a senior project. She was a long-term sub, a landscape architect. She introduced me to my boss for the next 6 years, who was an architect. And I worked for him, and I like to equate it to kind of like working for a military drill sergeant. He kind of beat it into me, and he knew I could take it. You know, if he was hard on me, I would just try to do better. So I worked for him while I was in college, and that's really where I would say he kind of formed my discipline in the industry. And it's just like, you know, as the architect, the buck stops with you. If one of your, you know, consultants isn't picking up the slack or something's going on, you got to be the one to figure it out, you know. And so I learned a lot of different things that I realized later I didn't really need to learn in order to be an architect. But it was, I appreciated that experience and knowledge. And it really paid off in the long run. I feel like, you know, that was I didn't get paid a whole lot there. And, you know, I was trying to get through college and everything. But in the end, moving into my career at the healthcare firm right upon graduation, I had a really good head start on that.
So that discipline you mentioned, like, what difference did that make, like, looking back, you know, that mentor you had and instilling that discipline into you, what difference did that make in your career up to this point?
I think that gave me a huge edge. I think it's taboo because we always talk about when we're looking for new people, when we're talking about people. I hate blaming things on a generation, but I've been labeled as a freak outlier in the millennial generation. I was born in 84, so I technically am a millennial, but I guess I don't fit the stereotype. I was taught through Paul McMahon that, like I said, if somebody isn't doing their part, it's up to you to pick it up and run with it and get it done. And it's just all about getting it done and, you know, no complaining. And, you know, I would say, you know, I'm not very good at lettering. And he'd say, oh, BS, just because you don't practice it. You could get good at it if you tried. You know, you just don't put the energy towards it. And I go, well, that's a good point. You know, it just wasn't important. You know, so a little bit different perspective. It's not I'm no good at this. It's I'm not willing to put the energy. It's kind of a different way of looking at it, I guess.
I really like that. I really like that idea.
Chuck, I got one for you. Okay. You graduate college. You're looking for a job. How did you get involved with CA Architects? Did you have a lot of other companies that you went through before you got to CA Architects? How'd that all come to place?
I would like to think that I really got lucky. I graduated in 2008. Things were starting to go off the cliff. Luckily, healthcare design is a little more stable than the rest of the industries. It fell as well, just a little bit later. It lagged a little bit on the recession. And I used every contact I knew in the industry to look for a job. And I wasn't dead set on healthcare or anything in particular. And not only was I not hired, but nobody even wanted to look at my resume because they said, you know what, we're not hiring right now. We're letting people go. We can't look at any new hires. Everywhere told me that. Because healthcare had a little bit of a delay, I just had heard about this firm because it was a local firm and I knew some people that knew some people that knew about it. I walked in the door and I think that was key. One of the smart moves I made. Instead of just calling and saying, send me an application, I walked in the door and I bumped into somebody that I knew there who happened to be the president's son. And I took a Long Beach City College, you know, architecture class and he was in it. And I said, oh, hey, Mark, how's it going? And I talked, I told him I went and got a degree at Pomona. And, you know, so he put in a good word for me. They were looking anyways. They didn't really see the recession coming yet. So I got in the door and I was the new guy for about 2 years because that was when it started to hit us. And I think mainly because of my work ethic and my personality, I mean, I came in entry level. I was a draftsman. They held on to me, you know, and some people had to be let go, unfortunately, but we did stay about the same size. through the recession. It was pretty minimal, but they held on to me, and I think it was, I have my previous employer and that to thank for that, because my discipline and willingness to step up to whatever they're willing to give me, I think is what helped that.
When you talk about work ethic, so expand on that a little bit. Like, what is your idea of work ethic, or what does that mean to you?
And pigging back on that, Justin, also with the work ethic, apply that to how you were able to move up in the company so quickly. I mean, you're the principal owner, you're 34 years old. To me, that sounds pretty young. So you must have some sort of leg up. And our listeners want to know what they can do to have that same leg up that you got.
Great question. I do believe the two go hand in hand. And, I think the discipline and not being presumptuous was, you know, I was surprised too when they offered me that position 3 years ago, 3.5 years ago. But I've been doing a lot of, soul searching and thinking, well, what did I do different from everyone else? And also being involved in interviewing and hiring, I can kind of see that a little more clearly too. So I guess when I say work ethic, it's essentially always having, the team goals at mind first, I guess, is the way to look at it. There's a lot of intricacies there, but it's really setting aside your own ego, which can be tough for architects stereotypically. We tend to be a down-to-earth kind of practical firm, the types of problems we have doing healthcare remodels. So, we do have a pretty good group of people that aren't real egotistical, because we're not super high design oriented. We are at times where we need to be. But
would you say that most architects are on the egotistical side?
But I have. I mean, any kind of skit reference you see at architects is kind of making fun of that, and I laugh at it because sometimes it our job, because we have to present, we have to take this like nebulous idea. The owner says, "I need something," and we have to show them something and be confident about it, instill confidence in them. We have to kind of act like that, even if we don't really want to. It's part of our job, I think, to be a little bit like that.
Well, walking that line of confidence and arrogance, right?
A little bit, yeah, and I hate that arrogant side. I really, like, when I see it, I go, oh my God, I hope I don't look like that to anybody. But I think the work ethic side, what I have always tried to do, and again, Paul McMahon kind of taught me this, is, he would give me a task that he knew darn well I had no idea how to even start. I say, give me wall sections out of this building. And I'd never done anything like it, right? I can barely use the drawing program. And so I kind of look at it, stare at it, and go, I don't know. And I'd come over and say, so where do I start? And he'd get frustrated with me, and he says, don't come to me with a problem you don't have an answer to. And, the intent was, you're the lower paid staff, think about it a little bit. Obviously, don't spin your wheels for weeks and weeks, just sitting there. But
your job is to figure it out.
Understand, right, exactly. Understand the what your constraints are. Start with something. Get it partway, and then come to me with pointed questions instead of making me generate, right? And that is I've kind of lived by that. And when I started, I immediately wanted to make myself valuable. Not with the intent of one-upping the next guy. I really, I've always enjoyed the people I work with, and I want to help everybody, and I expect them to kind of help me when I need help as well. And I'm not afraid to ask questions of anybody. I'll ask an entry level person, I don't know how to do this. Tell me with this. There's just, you try to break down those boundaries of, well, I should know, therefore I shouldn't ask. I don't like that. But what I would do is I would always, try to execute the task I was given at the highest level I understood, but also make it clear that of the things I wasn't sure about. And so when I handed that off to the person who delegated to me, it was the best I could do. And instead of just saying, well, you gave me some red lines and all I did was, do what you told me, and I'm a robot, and that kind of thing. So that is a big part.
Yeah, I hear a lot of it in there. In teaching leadership classes myself, I hear a lot of the things that we talk about when you're talking about this. Number one, taking responsibility for the whole project and everything you've been tasked to do. And then also being okay you know, not being the smartest guy in the room. It's like, hey, I don't know how to do this. Finding someone who does, and like you said, asking a new guy and not having that ego to go, oh, I know more than this guy does, or I should know more. So that's huge in leadership. And the fact that you're able to do that without getting offended and just be like, hey, let's put the right guys in the right place. You know, I hear a lot of those leadership skills in you, and those are super important to put the ego aside. And it's like, here's the task. Who's the right person for the job? Who knows what's going on in these different aspects? So I give you credit for that.
Thank you. You know, what's funny is that's just the way I worked and the way I was taught. And I thought I was just being useful by doing that. But now I've realized that I didn't know at the time that that was what leaders do. I thought I was just being a good employee, you know, and I, that's it. And now I've kind of learned, and I've seen that those, you know, now that I've watched other people move up, I've seen, yes, those are the leadership skills. I didn't realize I was doing it. And the other thing is not only that, but just showing respect no matter what. And I think you said it, like when you're giving a speech or something, you're nervous because people are judging you. Well, it's kind of the same thing with, you know, when you're, you know, working with somebody is, you know, you sometimes people can, you know, there's friction between people. Mm-hmm. But if you stop and think, you know, you ask a room of people, how many of you here are terrible people? Who's going to raise their hand, right? Nobody. So if you think about it, you think, well, that rubbed me the wrong way, but I have to assume they're just trying to get something done. That's a good thing. Yeah. So instead of combating that, you know, dig for more information. Well, why would you need it that way? Didn't you understand we have to get this done in a week? And I understand why you would want that, but that would take months and we only have a week, and here's what the owner needs, and this is what he needs to prevent to his boss, and so we're all just trying to help him out, and, you know, just seeking more information and talking about it. Yeah. It typically diffuses, you know.
Yeah, and that's a whole other thing there, being able to give reasons behind why we're doing things, or getting the other aspect of like, okay, why do we need this? Why do we need this? And giving reasons on why you need to perform a task in certain ways. That's super important.
Well, I want to shift gears a little bit, because now that Chuck is a principal owner, he has a hand in hiring. Mm-hmm. And I'd like to know what qualities he looks for in an employee that he's trying to hire. So, Chuck, can you elaborate on what type of employee you are looking for?
Yes, and I've been thinking about this one a lot, because there's not just one type of person you need in a company. You need a balance, right? And one of the wastes I hate is unutilized talent. And that can be unrecognized talent, right? And you have to oversimplify it, you have A types and B types, right? And the A types are kind of the obvious choices, and the part of the reason is they interview better. Right, they're confident and they can speak out and they can, which I'm failing at right
articulate.
Now. Articulate, thank you. I didn't mean to do that. They can articulate their thoughts and their processes, and generally when we're interviewing, I hate to say it because they told me this when I was in school, is nobody cares about your portfolio and your projects you've worked on. I'm sorry. Hmm. It would take too long to understand how you came up with those problems, and we kind of thumb through it and go, great, you know, if it's, you know, poor quality, you know, that says something. If it's nice quality, that says something. It only takes a minute to look at that and understand. Hmm. But the rest of it is really understanding your personality and how you might fit in. And a lot of it too is, how active were you during school? One of the big things for me that, you know, the partners at my firm say they recognize was, you know, I worked while I was in school. And what I see when we're interviewing at the college, not a lot of people do that. Or if they do, they only do the bare minimum because it's required at the school I went to. So they have only interned one summer. Well, I interned for 6 years straight, you know, and I would ditch school to go to work, which I don't recommend. It's just kind of the way I thought. And I knew that was the really valuable experience, was the work experience I was gaining.
So what insight does that give to you, someone that's working while they're going to school?
What insight does that give to me?
As far as looking at the people that you're trying to hire, you know, you said it's a factor in hiring them. So what insight does that give you finding the people that have worked while they were going to school?
It says something about work ethic, you know, that they, you know, because I don't know if they're, and this might be an indirect thing and a generalization, but if they just went to school and didn't work at all, it's kind of like, okay, well, do they have expectations that things are just going to be easy? And I don't know.
Or what about real world experience?
And absolutely, real world experience is valued much higher in the industry than school.
Mm-hmm.
Especially for, you know, not if you're at a Gensler, which is the biggest architect in the world, they're very high design. You have a PhD in architecture. That's great. You know, they probably love that.
Yeah.
Because you have new ideas and they have to be on the cutting edge of design. And, you know, we're applying ideas that have been tried and tested. We just apply the right ideas. So,
sure.
You know, that's forte. So having the real world experience is extremely important, and we really value that higher, especially if it's directly in healthcare. But you know what? Coming out of college, we don't expect very much. So we're really looking for that personality, and it's more tricky to find people that have been in the industry for years, and it's very risky to bring somebody in who's been in the industry for, say, 20 years that has never done healthcare.
Mm.
That's really hard for us to do.
And why is that?
Because they're likely a higher paying position, and we don't know, you know, if they're a good fit for our firm or if they can transition to the type of work we do, if they don't like it. And previous business owners, there's another one that's kind of risky.
So you want people you can mold.
Yes. So we're looking for personalities more than the experience. But part of the working during school tells something about their personality.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
So expand on the personality ideas on what you're looking for.
So part of what I was saying, the A types and the B types. The B types are a little bit harder to vet. We do get them, and I feel like I tend to be the advocate for the B types. I feel like the quiet ones are sometimes undervalued, and I feel like the quiet ones are sometimes the most valuable people because, you know, I'm too busy. I dump a task on somebody, and I'm amazed at what they come up with. And I go, if I sat there and looked at that all day, I wouldn't have found that. You know, when I let them know that, and I let other people know that,
mm-hmm.
and I make sure that they're taken care of because I feel like those people have passed up, and that really bugs me. But you know, that's another thing. I think we the firm, you know, in any business of any kind, really needs the A types and the B types.
That brings me to another question that I want to ask. You were talking about personalities, Chuck. Let's just say I'm a B personality. I know that might be hard to fathom. I'm 17 years old, and I thought to myself, you know what? I want to become an architect. I'm, you know, looking through schools. What would you tell a young B personality, Paul Fortune, how to become an architect at such a young age?
A B personality. Okay. I would probably nudge. I wouldn't worry so much about the A type because they will definitely seek opportunities, as I said, like kind of on the periphery and figuring out, you know, getting connected with the community, you know, finding, you know, clubs at their high school or finding the right colleges. And, you know, I don't want to discount the B personality being able to do that type of stuff, but I would probably encourage the B type more to do the things I would think they'd be less likely to do on their own. I'm sure they'll read through every book about it. They'll research and dive deep on what's the best college and figure out how to get in, and they'll definitely be academically performing very high, the B types. But I would want them to say, you know what, go outside and just build something. You know, go out and I don't know, I built skate ramps when I was a kid, but you know, work on your house if you're renting, you know, figure out how to fix an outlet or you know, get your hands dirty or trying to think of other things on the periphery, you know, join a local stuff. Take community classes and how to do cabinet making or something like that, and kind of broaden your horizon a little bit, because I feel like the B types tend to put their head down and go straight ahead.
So something to, like you said, broaden your horizons, get involved in more things, and maybe step out of your comfort zone a little bit
Definitely.
As that type B personality.
Step out of your comfort zone for sure.
Well, then I have a follow-up question on that. Okay, a B type personality, it sounds to me that means kind of a shy type personality. and you mentioned to us that interviewing, that's tough for the type B personality. So what would you tell that type B personality in interviews to be better, mm-hmm. to be more engaging, and to step out of that comfort zone that we've just talked about, be better in an interview?
So that's a good question. And as I think about it, I don't know that I would tell them to not be themselves. I mean, you don't want to try and fake something and be like, look at me, I'm outgoing, and be kind of force being bubbly. But, you know, the B type might be more matter of fact in their explanation and just explain all the different things you've done and try to emphasize that you have a really broad, you know, comprehensive knowledge of the trade and all the different things you've done. And I don't think you will be discounted for that. I think that's probably a good approach. I wouldn't try to fake something.
Yeah, and I like what you said there. You know, being authentic, I think, is huge when you're in an interview, and it can come across being fake if you're trying to be something that you're not. So I think that's a good insight there and good advice to keep true to what your personality is. And I pulled up, you know, just a quick definition of the type A and type B, just to kind of give our listeners a little bit of idea on what we're talking about here in case anyone's not familiar. A couple things. Type A personalities, we're talking about, they're more aggressive and ambitious or controlling and highly competitive, where type B personalities are more relaxed, less stress. It says emotional, and they could be have a laid back attitude. So rather than being that high press person pushing their ideas and out there, they're like, hey, you know, this is my idea. You know, if you like it, you like it. If you don't, you don't, kind of thing. Is that pretty much sum up the two type of personalities you've come across?
I think so. And I guess a little more to that, more of the outspoken, extroverted and introverted is also the way I kind of think of it. Mm-hmm. And I guess to speak a little bit to myself, I don't know which one I am. I think I'm kind of a hybrid. Because I think the definition of extroverted is being around people energizes you. And the definition of introverted is being alone energizes you. Yeah. And I can go both ways. I like to be alone and just sit down and grind something out and figure things out. And I'm having a lot of fun doing it. And other times I'll, you know, jump into a crowd and just start meeting new people, you know, and it kind of depends on my mood and what the, I guess what the time kind of calls for.
And the task at hand, right? You know, it all depends on what's going on and what you're trying to accomplish.
Right. And sometimes, you know, these things, you think of them as a spectrum, but sometimes the ends of the spectrum connect and it's more like a loop. Like, I always thought of myself as a good employee because I try to be as supportive as I can. Mm-hmm. Well, leader, the head of the company, really works for everybody else in the company, yes. Right? But at that way, they're there to support everybody and everything that's going on. And so I've just had that, you know, be supportive mentality.
Well, anyone that's a good leader has to be a good follower first. And I think that's really important to realize, because how do you expect to lead people if you have no idea how to follow?
And another thing that his message has been resonating with me is being humble. Hmm. Chuck is presenting an air of humbleness, and I think that's very important. And I think that's a quality, especially in the workplace, that's very inviting and probably one of the reasons why he moved up so quickly.
I just want to say I'm the most humble person I know. I think that's an important thing. I was thinking about this on the drive over is, you know, how do you, you know, part of doing business, I guess, and, you know, with your coworkers and with consultants and owners and everything, oftentimes construction can be an ugly thing. There's a lot of unknowns. There's a lot of money the owner has to shell out unexpectedly during construction at nobody's fault. And tensions can rise up in the room and my tactic, which it's one of those things where I just do it because it works. And then kind of later on, I figure out why it works is, you know, you throw something out that your tensions start to build up and somebody says, well, why would you do this? Or why would this happen? And it kind of gets silent. And I say, well, we were trying to make the building fall over, you know, and it's obviously a silly response and But then what that happens is it immediately drops the tension. Then you jump in with logic. People tend to be a little bit more receptive to it at that point. And I heard there was an experiment that somebody did. I heard this just recently on another podcast where You know, they had a formal experiment where they had a string with a ring attached in a room, and they brought people in. They said, okay, figure out a way to get this ring onto that hook with the string still attached. And it wasn't a very straightforward answer. Well, most people came in and they couldn't figure it out, and like, because the string wasn't long enough, and I don't know what the setup was, but the real experiment wasn't who could do it, who couldn't. What they did was the other group they brought in, and the person administering the test said, oh, you know, I just had these box of chocolates left over from my house. Would you like one? They're really good. They're, you know, See's candy or something. And people would say, oh yeah, sure. Oh, thank you. You know, very minor thing to kind of loosen up the mood, just a little bit of positivity. And what they found was when there was something humorous or something, you know, pleasant that happened, their brain switched to the other side. And instead of being drilled down, trying to figure out a very specific problem, they were more broad thinkers, more outside the box thinking, and were more likely to solve the problem because it wasn't so straightforward.
So they're saying they switched to the other hemisphere of the brain where it was more creative?
Yeah, and I thought that was interesting. They go, I think that's what happens when you're in a room full of people and, you know, somebody just makes kind of a little silly joke, and then all of a sudden now you get momentum and things start moving forward and happening because people stop trying to, you know, push their own very narrow-minded agenda, and they go, well, you know, there's also the engineer who needs to get paid, and there's a contractor who it's not really his fault, and you start thinking a little bit more big picture and going, yeah, there's a bigger context here. It's not just about me. And you tend to think more like a team. And I feel like that has always worked.
I like that. I like that idea. You know, doing something positive to get you in that, to the different side of the brain, to be able to, you know, trigger that creativity. I think that's super important.
Wow, we learned a lot today, I think, with having Chuck on. What do you think, Justin?
Yeah, I thank you for being on the show. I had so much more I wanted to talk about, you know, the Garage Mahal and all these other things, and the fact that your wife's an architect.
Yep, bring him back because he's doing some outside activities outside of working as an architect that we want to bring him on. Exciting stuff. He's getting into flipping homes and such, and that's something I'd like to talk to him about on another episode.
Yeah.
If you're coming back, Chuck.
Of course, anytime.
I would ask, just for today, if you could give, you know, just over what we talked about, you know, the hiring process or being focused and driven and being that good follower, you know, which ends up being the good leader. Like, what is like one or two things you would give as a piece of advice to someone trying to get into, it doesn't have to be architecture, right? But get into their career and then be successful at what they're doing.
So I think it doesn't matter what your career is, you know, architecture is architecture. It sounds all, you know, we all do the same thing, just a little bit different skill set, right? Mm-hmm. So I think biggest things are the, you know, interactions with people and those sorts of things. And I will say that what I've found is if you just, you know, set aside your differences with the people you work with, forget about competing. I'm very competitive, but see, I'm competitive with myself. Mm-hmm. I'll take something I don't know if I can do because I want to see if I can do it. And that's a better mentality, I think, than saying, well, I can do that better than them. And I hear that, and I kind of cringe at it. And I go, you know, don't compete with other people. Challenge yourself, support the people around you, and the things that you want will follow. Don't let those be the first thing you go after. I mean, I've heard people literally say, I want to be a leader. Mm-hmm. And I go, why? And of what? You know, because I've never said that. I never thought of myself that. I was uncomfortable with it at first, mm-hmm. but, you know, I've gotten a bit more comfortable with it, and I guess I could understand why. But, you know, that whole, I want to be a leader. Well, don't you want to know a little bit more about what you're doing before you're a leader? Or, you know, and I don't know.
And that's a whole separate conversation on leadership, because you don't really choose to be a leader. You get chosen to be a leader. Management is a little bit different. But I love what you said there about like putting your differences aside and really just kind of taking the responsibility and doing, you know, whatever the task is at hand. So thank you for that, Chuck. And one quick thing, I know we normally wrap up the show with an outrageous question for Paul. So being our guest, I want to give this, you know, opportunity over to you. Do you have an outrageous question for Paul?
I hope it's outrageous enough to your guys' standards, but I can think of more later if we do this again. But my question to Paul is, what do you believe is the single greatest invention of the 20th century?
I like it.
The 20th century?
Dark time.
Because my go-to answer, I don't think it's the 20th century.
Right? I know that. That's why.
Wow, you really threw me for a loop on this one. If you have to put me on the spot, I'm just going to go with an answer. I'm going to say the car.
Okay, automobile. I'm on board with that.
Yeah, I think that would be my answer. The automobile would be my number one answer, the best invention. Henry Ford, baby.
Connects us all over the world, right?
That's good enough.
I'm good with that. So again, Chuck, thank you for being on the show. It was awesome.
Thank you.
And hopefully we'll have you back on.
Definitely. Let me know.
Great. Paul?
Yeah. Thanks, Chuck. I appreciate it. This was a great show for Justin Atherton. This is Paul Fortune. See you next week.
All right. See you next Monday. Thank you for listening to the show. Please leave a comment and tell us what you thought about today's episode. Remember to subscribe using your favorite platform. We are on Apple Music, Google Play, Spotify, Amazon, and Stitcher, and we're featured on Podbean. If you have any outrageous questions you want to get out to Paul, please submit them to actionsandlimits@gmail.com, and your questions may be featured on our show.